You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Bio 190. Hopefully everybody knows my name is Kira that is taking the class. But for those of you that are maybe just joining in today, my name is Kira and I lead the class. Today we have Sandy with us, Sandy Troutwine,
right? Yes.
We were talking about her last name a little bit ago, who will be joining us talking about echinoderms and arthropods today. So real quick, just want to go over our weekly announcements as we usually do before we go live to the aquarium. We do have a little bit less than 3 weeks before our first paper is due, the field trip paper, so make sure you're working on that. And if you do get it done ahead of time, feel free to submit that. Remember, you have to attach the document. Don't copy paste anything into the comments. Has to be attached as either like a Word document or rich text format. We also have our research proposal that will be due at the end of the semester, so hopefully everybody is working on that. And as I stated last week, I did post the extra credit lab up, so take a look for that. There's a possible 5 points, which of course is very helpful. Now, I did get some emails from students about the quiz. There was a mistake on the quiz this last week, so what I'm going to do is take the quiz questions off so you don't get them right or wrong this week, so you don't risk losing points because there was a typo, and then there was also a confusing question about krill, which I'll address, and I'm going to put those questions back on next week's quiz. So this week's quiz will be a point shorter than normal. Next week's quiz will be an extra point than what we would normally have. So again, if you have any questions, please let me know. And I'll address that stuff right after. We do have our midterm that will open up next week after class. So next week will be a busy week. You'll have the discussion board, a quiz, and the midterm. The midterm will be the first 6 classes. So a cumulative test on the first 6 sessions that we had. So again, if you have any questions, you can email me at bio190@lbaop.org. And I'll be happy to answer those questions for you. And as always, if you have questions during the class, comments, want to share, make sure you email or call in. All right, so we want to jump straight to our live at the aquarium. We are at our spider crabs today because they do relate quite a bit to what we're talking about. So if we can go see them, I think we have Alicia with us today. Alicia, are you there?
Hi, Kira. Hi, Sandy. How are you?
Hi.
Pretty good. We're just getting ready to start. We're going to be talking about arthropods and crustaceans on the second half of the class. And I know we got lots of fish going on in there, but we have other animals too, right?
Yeah, definitely. We were just talking with guests about the Pacific cod and our Boccaccio in here. The Boccaccio is actually swimming right in front of the exhibit. And behind us in the background, we have our giant spider crabs.
Yeah, we can barely make them out just because they're in the shadow. Is there maybe a way we could zoom in on them just to get a little bit better look? I know it's kind of a
sure,
dark
we're gonna try
exhibit.
That.
Awesome.
Cool.
Now, we can see them pretty good here, but as far as size, how big would you say our spider crabs are?
Well, they are very large, and I would tell you that our guests are always impressed. And maybe Sandy can help me out with the actual size here, but they have been recorded at being up to 3 meters long. Ours aren't quite that large, but they're definitely sizable animals, and they range a little bit with our exhibit animals.
And we can find those where, Alicia?
These are going to be deep ocean animals, deep Pacific. These are Japanese spider crabs in particular.
And as far as the crabs in there, they don't seem to be going after the fish at all. Are there ever any issues with that, you think?
No, the predation actually would be a little bit more when they are molting. They would, I would say, turn a little bit more on themselves. So as they, and I'm sure you're going to talk about shedding those outside skeletons, but when they do that, they're very vulnerable. And when that happens, we have to separate the animal because they will prey on themselves as their tissues are very soft at that point.
Perfect. And I was going to say, looking at them there, I don't see big pinchers. I know lots of people, when they think of crabs, they think of big pinchers. Do they have pinchers like other crabs?
No, they're more of a foraging animal. You know, to address that predation, they will pick on each other, but the fish in here are too fast for them. They're going to look for things that have already died at the deep ocean depth. So they're going to be scavenging, they're going to be picking. So they don't have those really large claws. They have more detailed claws that will help them tear and shred.
How many do we have? Can you see? We see the two there. Are there more in the exhibit?
Absolutely. In fact, I was just talking with guests that in order to keep track of them, they have what look like wristbands, but they're little zip ties over their legs with color codes so they can keep track and for their husbandry records know who's eating what. And so we have at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I can see. There's one behind the large rock structure, but we're just looking at two.
Super cool. And the fish that loves to go front and center there.
Picatio is a camera hog.
Yeah, for sure. They must know that they're
I think they're
going
saying
live.
They want their own show.
Do you have any fun facts about the crabs that you wanted to share, the spider crabs?
Sure. Actually, the one that really stood out to me is that they believe they can live around 100 years.
That's a pretty impressive age there for spider crabs. And we'll be talking a lot about like their reproduction and their, or just in general, arthropods, life cycle and stuff. So thank you, Alicia, for showing us the spider crabs and getting us started today. So we'll let you get back to work.
All right. Thank you, Kira. Thank you, Sandy.
All right. We'll see you next time, Alicia. All right.
Bye-bye.
So perfect. And as Alicia said, oh, well, maybe Sandy would know how big our spider crabs are because Sandy does a lot of work with these types of animals. And we get a really special treat towards the end of class today. We're actually going to be dissecting a crab that Sandy brought with her. So with that, Sandy, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? I'm super excited to have you here. I've never gotten the chance to really work with Sandy before, so I'm sure I'm going to learn a lot today, too.
Cool. Well, yeah, I am currently the curator of fish and invertebrates at the Aquarium of the Pacific. And as curator, I oversee all of the collection of fish and invertebrates and supervise a staff of excellent biologists that help to take care of these animals. I also have a PhD from UCLA in biology, and I did my research on coral crabs, which are tiny little crabs that live among the corals, and I was lucky enough to discover 4 new species. So my background is really in corals and crabs and systematics and tropical coral reef biology, but I have a great interest in all of the ocean's creatures, so I'm delighted to be here today and talk about that.
Awesome. I cannot wait, seriously. Yeah. So we'll go ahead and get started then on today's section. So we have 2 essential sections today. The previous classes that we've had have kind of been habitat-based so far. We haven't really gotten into talking about the specifics of animals, although we did have a pretty cool video we showed of the coral crab defending.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. So anyway, we're now going to be transitioning into really looking into different animals. Today we'll be talking about 2 phylums. So if you were talking about taxonomy, we would go kingdom, phylum. So animal kingdom and then the phylums. The first phylum we're going to talk about today are echinoderms. And echinoderms breaks down pretty easily, right? Mm-hmm. If we were going to break down the words, what does it mean?
Spiny skin.
Spiny skin. So that would include sea stars, sea urchins, sea cucumbers, and all the like. So let's jump in and start talking about these spiny skinned animals. And they have some very specific characteristics, just like if you were talking about jellies. Jellies have certain characteristics. Echinoderms also have, in general, specific characteristics. What are some of those?
Well, some of the more interesting characteristics are radial symmetry. That means that they are basically the same on both sides, no matter how you rotate the animal. They lack a head, so there's really no anterior and posterior surface or dorsal and ventral surface. There's just really an oral or a mouth surface, and then an aboral or an not mouth surface. And again, these are all textured and bumpy surfaces, with the exception of sea cucumbers, which are bilaterally symmetrical. They also have an endoskeleton, which is like ours, actually, in that you have a hard skeleton underneath some soft tissue. You wouldn't really think of that when you look at something like a sea urchin, mm-hmm. because it looks pretty spiny and it looks like it has an exoskeleton. But actually, that sea urchin test, as they call it, is covered with a thin layer of ciliated tissue. And again, they have these spines, so they're very spiny skinned. They also have a very unique water vascular system, and this is unique to echinoderms only. They have water-filled canals, and they can use these canals as muscular extensions called tube feet.
And we actually have a visual, so if we can pull up the water vascular system picture, we can show you a little bit what that looks like, and we'll walk you through that. So if we can pull that picture up, there we go.
Yeah, that's a sort of a diagram of what the water vascular system looks like, and you can see it ends in these tube feet, and these tube feet can be used for locomotion. So when they press along against an object, the water is released from them, and that creates a suction effect. And then as water fills the tube feet, the suction is released. So obviously, this is not a very quick mode of locomotion, but it does the trick. And actually, sometimes some sea stars, like sunflower stars, can move very quickly. So it's very surprising.
We have a video as well that we can show of a sea star kind of moving. You can see kind of how slow it is. It's, for me, it was always faster than I thought. Yeah. I mean, still obviously very slow, but I remember watching a sea star when you just stop and watch and observe for a while. You're just like, wow, that guy's kind of booking it a little bit faster than I would have ever thought. So why don't we cue up that video and we can see kind of those 2 feet in action moving over the surface of a rock, and you'll kind of get an idea of what speed we're looking at here. So there's the 2 feet. You can see them kind of poking out from the bottom there. And we have some pictures that we can show you too after this, but this is just, he's slowly kind of making his way over the rock here.
And actually, these tube feet are used to collect oxygen and dispose of cellular waste as well. So this is where all of the sort of the oxygenation of the animal goes on as well. So it's kind of cool.
And again, this is underneath. So this isn't the spiny skin per se that we're talking about. We're looking at the underside of a sea star where these tube feet are. So they're not like up on top or anything like that. These are all underneath. Little wiggly fingers. Yeah, we play a game at the aquarium with high school students, and one of the questions, it's a true false, is do animals, are there animals that can breathe with thousands of feet?
Oh.
And the answer is true, because sea stars do.
Yeah.
Real quick, let's look at a close-up of a top of a sea star. We have a couple of pictures, maybe a crown of thorns would be kind of a cool one. Or a giant spine sea star. Either one of those pictures, we can kind of see the top layer and that spiny skin that we were talking about. If we can go full screen on that.
Now, this one's of particular interest to me since I study corals. These crown of thorns sea stars are actually coral predators, and they are venomous with these really spiny spines. Interestingly enough, the coral crabs that I study actually pinch and nip at these sea stars to drive them off the coral, which is their habitat.
So they have that symbiotic relationship. And this little video is so funny. I'll have to show it to you, but it has the Rocky theme music.
Oh.
This little crab is just going to town on the 2 feet of this crown of thorns. So it's pretty funny.
Great.
So you can really see there that the spikes are on the top there, and then the 2 feet more so are on the bottom. And got a good idea about that locomotion with the 2 feet there. And then let's talk a little bit about the ecology and range of these types of animals. So there's a lot of species.
Yeah, there are. There are about 6,000 species, and they are exclusively marine, which is really unusual for a whole group, especially a whole phylum. They range in different habitats from the intertidal zone all the way down to the deep sea, and they range from sandy shores to rocky substrates, so you can find them virtually everywhere. And they are found in various temperature zones, from tropical to the cold sea.
Wow. So yeah, I mean, we don't. I've always thought of Sea Stars as this rocky inner tidal, but do we know? Do you know like what the deepest they've been found, or maybe the coldest, or?
No, I don't. But you can certainly find them in the Arctic and the Antarctic.
Yeah.
So
I remember a video or like a news article a couple years ago about these sea stars that were found up around Alaska that were just bigger than they'd ever imagined. So
wow.
I just remember going, wow, I didn't realize, you know, they'd be that big or that in that cold of water. So
yeah.
Kind of interesting there. All right, so we're going to jump down and talk a little bit about different types of echinoderms now that we kind of understand what makes an echinoderm. So pretty much all of the echinoderms that we're going to talk about will have these characteristics that we just mentioned. So the first type being sea stars, right? We already saw the crown of thorns, which is a type of sea star, but there's lots of sea stars. So we'll kind of get into those as a certain type of echinoderm. And they have a very interesting way of feeding.
Yes, they do. They are mostly carnivorous, but some of them feed on sponges, bryozoans, tunicates, mollusks, and other even detritivores. Although some of them are specialized feeders, like the crown of thorn sea star that we just talked about, who only eats live coral. They don't have any mouth parts to capture their prey, which is very unusual, mm-hmm. but instead they use their tube feet to create this very powerful grip on their prey. And they also bring their stomach to their food. They don't actually bring the food to the stomach. And what they do is they extrude their stomach and they actually release digestive juices that liquefy their prey. What a way to go, huh?
Does not sound so fun.
No, and it is pretty amazing to see a sea star extrude its stomach and slip into the tiniest slit of the two valves of a mussel, the two shelves of a mollusk, and then put its stomach in there and just liquefy the prey inside. So it's pretty fascinating the way they feed.
And we get to see that. Their stomach is gelatinous. So imagine that if you were going to eat a pizza, you had a piece of pizza on a plate, you would like throw your stomach up. Your stomach would surround the pizza, release acids and juices and make it into like a big old pizza slurry and then absorb it and then suck your stomach back in your mouth. It's just incredible. I mean, that's how sea stars, or most sea stars, do their feeding. Do all sea stars do it that way? Or
I'm pretty sure, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure if, like, you know, because you can't ever say all, right?
Right.
But
yeah.
Who knows, right? So as far as we know, all of them do that.
Yeah.
So really, really cool. What I want to do now is show a video, and this is super cool. I found this today, but as Sandy was saying, imagine if you've ever gone to the beach, there's mussels and clams, and they have two shells. And those suckers are locked. I mean, there's no pulling those guys apart unless you have a screwdriver
yeah.
or a hammer or whatever. So all they need, like Sandy was saying, is the tiniest little crack. And they're going to get their stomach down in there and then bye-bye animal. So we have a video where the video actually has, at one point, a camera inside the mussel. I think it's a mussel. Right before the sea star goes to digest and drop its stomach in. So we'll get to see that. It's super cool. So if we can pull that sea star eating the mussels, that video up, that would be awesome.
Like an advancing army, the sea stars move into position, slowly but surely working their way up toward their victims. The mussels cannot run or fight. All they can do is hide within their shells as their killers crawl over their bodies. Sensory tube feet sweep over the tightly packed mass of shells, searching for any gap in the mussels' defenses. Settling on its victim, the sea star hunkers down and begins its attack. The miniature camera, tucked within the mussel shell, gives us the first look ever at the carnage that unfolds here every day. Once the tube feet have physically breached the mussel's defensive line, the sea star's translucent stomach begins the final assault. the animal actually pushes its stomach inside the mussel's shell, unfolding like a fatal flower. The stomach unleashes a volley of chemical weapons, digestive juices that dissolve the mussel's soft pink flesh. All that's left is a nutrient-rich soup, a broth that's quickly absorbed by the sea star. Having assimilated the mussel, the sea star stomach pulls away. And the animal moves on, leaving behind an empty shell. Without the benefit of speed, brains, or brawn, sea stars are amazingly successful predators.
That was the coolest video.
That is very cool.
I've never seen anything like that before. So you really get an idea of literally what's going on inside of that muscle as it's digesting the tissue, which is just so cool. And they brought up a good point. So they were saying that the sea star is moving around in senses and its surroundings. How do they sense their surroundings?
That's a good question. I think it's mostly just by chemical cues in their mm-hmm. environment, and mainly smell, although it's not the same kind of smell that we have. But they definitely know, like when we feed the sea stars at the aquarium, they will all go to where the clams are or whatever we're feeding that day, so they can smell it very quickly.
And they have modified tube feet that are kind of like eyes, right? But it's not like eyes, but they can sense dark spots and light spots, right? Like,
yeah.
It's like at the end of each arm, it's like we always try and explain it. Like if you were to close your eyes and put your hand over your eyes and then put your hand away and put it back, like you can sense like light and dark, even though your eyes are closed and you can't see. And,
yeah.
And that's kind of always how we perceive those eye spots on their tube feet. So just sensing shadows and light, but really cool. I mean, no brain, no heart. None of that. So they're able to figure it all out and not think about it sexually. Now, how do these guys reproduce? Because that seems like a challenge if they're not conscious of stuff. So how does that happen?
Well, they have two modes of reproduction. One is asexual and the other is sexual. So with the asexual part, a sea star can lose all but one arm. As long as part of the central disc is still attached to that arm, then they can regrow all of their arms.
Wow.
And if a sea star is split in two, each half may grow back the missing portion and become two sea stars, which has become a real problem with the crown of thorn sea stars, because that was such a predator in some tropical areas that local people were trying to get rid of them by cutting them up, only to find out that they were making new sea stars.
Four or five new sea stars per sea star.
So. Right, so they stopped doing that. But there also is sexual reproduction, where there's external fertilization forming a ciliated free swimming larvae. And then they do have a defense mechanism where they, in between each of their spines, they have these little extra appendages called pedicellaria, and these are used to defend themselves. So that's reproduction and sort of defense.
Defense and all kind of wrapped up. Yeah, that's how we have it here.
Yeah.
So with the defense, though, can you feel them if you touch the top? Would you be able to feel?
On some of them, you can. If you hold your hand over some of the larger stars, sometimes you can feel it. But we have sea stars that you can touch, so don't worry when you come visit the aquarium. They won't pinch you.
We have lots of stuff to touch at the aquarium. Allie has a question. How fast do sea stars move? Do we know?
I don't have a miles per hour.
not very fast. So the video that I showed initially where we just kind of saw it going over the rock for that particular species, which I think was a giant spiner, maybe an okra star, that was real time. That wasn't like sped up or anything like that. So if you watch, I know there are some videos that show like them moving, and if you ever come to the aquarium, just sit back and watch and you'll see them kind of move, especially if we put some food in there. They'll just like start kind of moving, and it's not fast, but it might be faster than you think. And Abigail, how many mussels will the sea star eat per day, or how often do they eat? Also, do they travel in groups? I don't think they travel in groups. They're pretty solitary animals, right? I mean,
yeah, they are. Although, you know, because they're found in different zones, like if you go to the intertidal zone along our coast, you'll definitely see a lot of sea stars, and it kind of looks like they're in groups, but they don't. They're not really like a group type animal.
And, or like working together, right? They don't work together to get their food, so they're pretty independent on their own. So there wouldn't really be a reason to be together. I mean, not even defense, right? I mean, their skin is spiny skinned, and they're able to defend themselves okay. And then how many mussels will a sea star eat per day? Do we know on average?
Well, at the Aquarium of the Pacific, we generally feed our sea stars about 3 times a week because, you know, a mussel is a pretty big meal for them and can last a couple of days. So I wouldn't think they eat very often in the wild either, like probably just a big meal and then they wait maybe a day or two and then find some other food to eat.
Right, and of course, depending on the species, that will range, right? Like some of our bat stars, which are smaller, we would maybe feed them a little less. Is that the case?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, so there will be kind of a big range there depending on the different species. So, all right, hopefully that answers your question, Abigail. Thank you for typing that in. And now we're going to move on to another type of spiny-skinned animal, so another echinoderm, but these are sea urchins. And I think that everyone at the aquarium is always afraid of the sea urchins. Like, oh, I can't touch those. But we let people touch the sea urchins. So maybe we can pull up a picture real quick and we'll start talking about these guys. So they're pretty spiny.
They are very spiny. They are definitely spiny skinned, and they're very interesting animals because, again, they have this endoskeleton. So there's a live tissue around the surface of them with the spines coming out. And so this endoskeleton is what we see when the sea urchin dies. All of the spines fall off and we find just this white test is left. And oftentimes, if you're lucky enough, you can find an Aristotle's lantern. And an Aristotle's lantern is basically what a sea urchin uses as its teeth to graze on algae, which is what most sea urchins eat. But they'll also feed on sponges, bryozoans, ascidians, and detritus.
So they eat a lot, but their main thing is kelp, and we've actually talked a little bit about how sometimes sea urchins will completely monopolize an area, and we call that a sea urchin baron, is that right?
That's right.
So they'll just come in and wipe out areas of a kelp forest by eating all the holdfasts that hold those kelp down. So those are some pretty strong trompers. And you know what? Darn it, there is a video that we have that shows them eating. And I wish I would have thought to bring it. I'm going to post that for you guys. It's really awesome. And if we can bring up the picture of that Aristotle's lantern, maybe you can walk us through kind of what we're seeing here. So if we can pull that full screen.
Yeah, so that's the bottom of the sea urchin is cut away. And in the very center of that bottom are the teeth. And this is called the Aristotle's lantern because when the sea urchin dies, this piece stays together and looks sort of like a lantern. So, but the teeth are actually what graze along the algae and scrape the rocks. And you can see they're pretty strong looking teeth.
Yes, this video that we have, maybe I'll find it during the break. It's just so cool. You can see it, like they kind of fast motion it, and you can just see them coming out, just chomping away at the kelps, and it's so cool.
Oh, that's very cool.
So bummed I didn't think about that. So, all right, I will get that for you guys one way or another. Real quick, Philip has the question, what are predators of sea stars? If they are that big of a problem, have them eaten by the predators. So I don't know, are sea stars a problem? Or you're talking about sea urchins, but are sea stars a problem?
Sea stars are generally not a problem. The crown of thorn sea stars that we showed you earlier, that is a problem. For some reason, there can be these massive outbreaks of crown of thorn sea stars, and these sea stars get huge. And they eat coral. So, for example, I was in Moorea a few years ago teaching a class, and I had been there a couple of years before, and the reefs were beautiful and pristine. 2 years later, when I returned, they had an outbreak of crown of thorns, and it decimated the corals. I mean, there were no coral reefs left. And you can imagine a place like Moorea that's dependent on tourism and diving, how it affects them. Unfortunately, the crown of thorns doesn't have many predators. There is a snail, I believe it's called the triton, or I can't remember the exact name, but a large predatory snail that will eat the crown of thorns sea star. Unfortunately, there's not enough of them to control these massive outbreaks of the crown of thorns. So there really aren't any solutions to this. And really what happens in these areas with these great outbreaks is that they just let the population eat everything, and then there's no food left for them to eat. So eventually they go away, but the problem does come back, and nobody knows why these big outbreaks occur.
What about other sea stars? I mean, are you familiar with any other predators of sea stars? And it's never just as simple as introducing the predator into the environment anyway. It's not just that simple, right? So you couldn't just say, oh, well, a natural predator is a snail. Let's just produce a bunch of snails and go drop them off in the area. It wouldn't quite work that way, because that could really throw the balance off in other ways that maybe we're not even aware of. But what about other sea stars? What would other predators be, maybe? Like birds, right? We've seen birds.
Possibly. I don't think there are many, though, honestly.
Sea otters sometimes will eat. We always joke around, like, little sea star sandwiches where they'll put two sea stars together.
Yeah.
So the 2 feet stick to each other, and then they just eat sea stars. But, yeah, I don't.
Maybe crabs? I've seen crabs in the aquarium when we have crabs and sea stars together. Oftentimes the crabs will pick on the sea stars a little bit, but that's really the only thing I can think of.
And in a lot of cases, as we talked about with the tide pools, the sea stars are very important because they're keystone species. They help to keep the balance of that whole environment there. So we wouldn't want to necessarily, I mean, in the case of the crown of thorns, that could be an issue. But otherwise, it's probably a good thing that there's not tons of stuff out there eating the sea stars. So, All right, and back to sea urchins now. So we're talking about those spiny guys. How do they defend themselves? They have all those spikes, right? But is there more to it than that?
They have spines, and actually all sea urchins, to one extent or another, do have venom in their spines. And they also have these pedicellaria that we talked about before, which they use to defend themselves as well as to clean their surfaces. Like if they get a bunch of sand dumped on them or something, then they can use these pedicellaria to help clean the surface. So those are basically the two things, is that they, oh, I'm sorry, the pedicellaria contain the toxin, not all spines. Although there are some spines of like long-spined urchins in the tropics that have venomous spines. So to some degree, all urchins do have venom, but again, we allow our guests to touch them. It's sort of like the venom is so mild to us that we don't feel it at all, but to something that's trying to eat it, maybe it helps to deter it from eating it. So.
And speaking of the ones that have the giant spine, or what was it called with the venom?
The long spine.
The long spine. One of the questions that I think I always get at the aquarium is, oh, well, don't they shoot their spines out? But they don't—they don't shoot their spines out,
no,
right?
No. Yeah.
If you were to step on it, I mean, you'd get one through your foot. But they're not like a porcupine that can launch out spines at you. So you don't have to worry about that. And again, at the aquarium, we have tons for you to touch. So now, if you look really closely, you can see the 2 feet moving around. And I think it's always funny when people go, "Oh, it's giving me a hug." They put a finger around some spines, and the spines close up.
Oh, yeah.
On the finger, but they're not really giving him a hug, right?
No.
I think they're just worried that you're getting your finger in there and they don't know what's going on, so they're closing up to prevent you from getting any further. But they're giving you a hug.
Yeah.
All right. So those are our sea urchins. And then one other kind of famous echinoderm that I love to talk about, I think this is probably one of my favorites, but are the sea cucumbers. They're just so cool.
Yeah, they are very cool.
And what makes a sea cucumber different? If we can bring up a picture, I mean, this doesn't look anything like a sea star, but
no. Well, they're bilaterally symmetrical, which is what we talked about before. So it's sort of like us, where if you cut them down the center, both sides would be matching. And so they have that, where they don't have the radial symmetry of the urchins and the sea stars.
Right. So if we just cut it down that way, it would be the exact same on both sides.
Right.
This side would match this side.
Right. And then, but there again, they do have a mouth and an anus. So they have a head and sort of an oral and aboral section, again, is what we talked about before. And these sea cucumbers are so fascinating because We have them in a lot of our aquarium exhibits because they are deposit feeders, which means they eat a lot of detritus and things that are found in the sand and help keep the sand clean. So we love them for that. They'll scoop up, they have these long tentacles mm-hmm. where they scoop up big mouthfuls of sand and then filter out any of the organic parts. Digest those and then excrete the excess sand. So they're really fascinating.
I read something today actually that said something like I don't know what kind of species of sea cucumber it was, but they can filter out like 300 pounds of sand a year.
Wow.
It was something crazy like that. I'm pretty sure it was 300 pounds of sand a year they will clean.
Process. That's so amazing.
That's quite a bit of sand there.
Yeah.
And they have kind of a unique way of avoiding predators.
Yeah, they do. So they don't have the spines that we've seen with the sea urchins, but they do secrete toxins. And one of the most interesting things they are known for is evisceration. Again, that's evisceration, and this is where they will actually expel their gut and other internal organs mm-hmm. to distract predators. And so the predator, instead of picking on the sea cucumber, will pick on these internal organs and then can grow back these internal organs, amazingly enough, and just continue on.
So there's that regeneration that goes with echinoderm. So even though they don't actually have spikes, it kind of looks like spikes or it mimics spikes. So they've got the spikes, they've also got 2 feet on the bottom,
mm-hmm.
and then they are able to regenerate, in this case, their actual entire gut and gonads and everything. I mean, it just up it comes. And I also heard, and I don't remember the exact time frame, but if they haven't had a reason to eviscerate, they actually do it on their own. Like they're like, oh, it's time to get rid of these and then regenerate them. So.
Wow.
We did an update for some of our volunteers like a couple months ago, and we were reading that. We're like, wow, so they'll do it anyway just to kind of freshen everything up.
That's cool.
And get it all cleaned up. So kind of cool there. And at the aquarium, I love talking to people and saying, this is not a snail.
Right.
It's not a slug. It looks like a slug, but I kind of picture it as taking a sea star and breaking an arm off, and then you've got the sea cucumber. Almost, obviously, it's a totally different animal, but it's like just a section almost. So,
yeah.
So kind of cool there. And they have some very interesting symbiotic relationships. I'm thinking of the pearlfish.
Yeah. I've always looked for pearlfish on my diving adventures. I've never seen one. But pearlfish are very cool. They're this long cylindrical fish.
We have a picture. We should be able to bring one up. If we can bring the picture up of the pearlfish, we can talk about that. Oh, not that one. We're a little bit further than that. We're towards the end here. So it should be right after.
There we go. So you can see it's long and thin and sort of tapered on one end. And this actually lives in the gut cavity and leaves and enters through the anus tail first. And it feeds on the gonads and the tissues of the cucumber. So you would think, oh my gosh, this is terrible. The pearlfish is eating the cucumber from the inside out. But what we call this is a symbiotic relationship, and it's probably a mutualistic symbiotic relationship where the pearlfish is maybe nibbling on some of those parts, but again, the sea cucumber can regenerate those parts, so it's not actually hurting the sea cucumber. And it may help the sea cucumber in avoiding other predators. Maybe mm-hmm. it helps to chase other predators away.
Sure, that would make sense. Kind of like the crab and the coral and the crown of thorns, exactly. And then real quick, just backing up, we didn't get a chance to see, but we had a picture of the feeding arms or tentacles. What do you call that? Of the sea cucumber feeding.
I call them tentacles, but I don't know if there's a name for them.
I'm not sure. I think it's feeding tentacles as well. But if we can show that picture, there we go. This will kind of show you what happens. These reach out and start grabbing the bits out of the sand. So this is like the mouth opens up almost, and this is what comes through, right?
And these can also be a filter feeders. So they can have these feeding tentacles to go through the sand, but they can also extend them in these beautiful plumes that look like feathers, which capture plankton out of the water. And then each arm just sort of brushes the plankton off into the mouth. So we have some of those at the aquarium as well.
Super cool. Yeah. I don't know. There's just something so fascinating about sea cucumbers.
Yeah.
Kind of like them.
Me too.
And just a couple other different species of echinoderms. We're just about to wrap up with this particular type of phylum. We're about halfway through the class. But there's a couple other unique species like sand dollars, right? People sometimes will go down to the beach and, oh, they found a sand dollar. But those are related to echinoderms, right?
Yeah, these are so cool. You can actually go to any of our local beaches, like Redondo Beach. And if you are a diver, you go down about 10 or 15 feet, you'll see big beds of these just sitting there. And they are so interesting because they will bury into the sand vertically. Now you would think that, you know, they lay horizontally on the sand, but actually
we
to get most of the filter feeders out of the water, like plankton and things, which they eat, they prefer to stand vertically in the sand. And you can see this behavior at the aquarium in the Pacific. We have a big tank full of them, which is really
Redondo
cool.
Canyon, right?
Yes.
It's called, literally, speaking of Redondo, right, the Redondo Canyon exhibit. And yeah, they'll just kind of sit up, and they have the same characteristics of an echinoderm, because they're an echinoderm, so the radial symmetry and also the tube feet. And what would they regenerate, do you know?
I don't know what they would regenerate. But,
maybe tube feet or something like that?
Probably. But they, again, have this in endoskeleton, and that's what you see when you are holding a dried sand dollar, is the skeleton. But on the outside is this beautiful purple coloring, and it has, you can see the spines. They're very small, but they're still there, and the tube feet. So they're very cool.
Yeah,
I think
everybody loves sand dollars.
Yeah.
Right? So. All right. Well, we are just about halfway done with the class, so we will go ahead and take a break. When we come back, we will do crustaceans and arthropods. So we'll talk about why I'm calling it arthropods and crustaceans when we get back. So we'll take a 5-minute break. Go ahead and get a drink, get a snack, do what you got to do, and we will see you in just a couple minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We're passing out information for all the parents that come in, so we're letting them know where the workshops are, what time, and what to find inside the gym.
Junior at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. These are the schools I want to apply to.
So it's really, really exciting that we are trying to increase like the amount of students that go into college.
My name is Cheetah Chin, and I'm currently majoring in liberal studies. I'm involved with Toro Productions, and I love working with DHTV here on campus. I chose Cal State Dominguez Hills because of its small class sizes.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
This student life.
sweet.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. Hopefully you had a good break. We are going to open up right now before we get started with our mystery item for today. So this will give you one extra credit point if you can tell me what this is. Hopefully this is a little bit of an easy one and you're back from your break, because it's probably going to be a typing war to see who can figure this out first. So we'll get an overhead shot here. And the first person to either call or type in will get the extra credit point today. So this is obviously for people that are only watching the class live. So if you know what this is, move it around here a little bit. See the underside, tail. All right, so if you think you know what that is, type in, and first person to get it will get an extra credit point. In the meantime, though, we will get started in talking about arthropods, and this relates to it. Obviously, our mystery item relates to it, mm-hmm. So good luck with that. And let's first by talking about, or start by talking about what arthropods are. Another type of phylum, but they too have characteristics, right?
Yep. Arthropod basically means joint foot. So they are animals that, when we think of arthropods, we generally think of bugs. But arthropods are so much more mm-hmm. than bugs. They include not only insects, but crabs, shrimp, millipedes, even the extinct trilobites, which have been around for a long, long time. So they are the most diverse group of animals. At least half of the 1.4 million described species are arthropods. Mostly insects, of course, but they have a very long evolutionary history, and their fossil record dates back to 530 million years ago.
That's phenomenal. Yeah. So still around. I mean, these animals are, some of them, ancient looking, and it's because they've literally been around forever. There's also lots of them, right? This is like the biggest phylum.
Yeah, this is the largest phylum. And I think a lot of it has to do, of course, with their long evolutionary history, of course. They've had lots of time to fill different niches throughout their evolutionary history. But they also have a very close relationship to plants, of course. When we think of insects, we think of plants. So this co-evolution with plants or algae mm-hmm. has been a powerful force in the radiation of arthropods. They are the first flying animals, which is kind of cool.
Yeah.
And the segmentation, the fact that they are segmented, they're very closely related to annelids, which are also segmented. This allows for lots of different body plans or bowel plans, mm-hmm. which allow them to have evolutionary processes act on them.
And segmentation just means broken up, right? Their bodies are kind of broken up into different parts or different sections,
right,
essentially.
Right. Essentially, with arthropods, some of the characteristics that define arthropods are the fact that they have these segmented bodies where they have a head, a thorax, or chest, an abdomen, and as I mentioned, their closest relatives are annelids. And so they, whereas annelids are soft, arthropods are hard. They also have jointed appendages, and that's again what the name means. Arthropod means joint foot. And so they have this hard body that's segmented with these jointed appendages. It's kind of, how do they move around so much? Well, these jointed appendages mm-hmm. have allowed for great radiation. And so each body segment has a pair of these jointed appendages, which allow a great range in specialization. They also have an exoskeleton, which is made of chitin. These arthropod bodies are hard, and they have this exoskeleton. Unlike what we just talked about with the endoskeletons of the echinoderms, this is a hard skeleton on the outside that you would think would restrict their movement. But again, their movement problems were solved by having these segmented bodies and jointed appendages. And also, what about growth? Like, how does something with a hard exoskeleton grow? Well, they have come up with a way of doing that called ecdysis, or molting, mm-hmm. which we'll talk about in a little bit. And the last characteristic is compound eyes. So they don't have like one pinpoint view like we do. They have sort of a mosaic of different photoreceptive cells that sort of all overlap each other. And this is good for detecting movement, but not the greatest visual acuity in many cases. And that visual acuity really depends on the amount of overlap of each of those units. So those are some of the major characteristics of arthropods.
Perfect. All right. Well, we have had a ton of people calling, and well, one calling at least, and answering. And I believe, Warren, maybe you can help me with this. I think Abby was first, and Abby got it correct. She said, is it a horseshoe crab? Yes, it is. And then I'm not sure who's on the line, but we can go to them real quick and see if they have the same guess. So I see our light is on. So we have Crystal calling from Chino Hills. Crystal, what did you think it was?
Hi, I think it was a horseshoe crab.
Yeah, it was a horseshoe crab, and I think Warren will have to confirm who got in first. Pretty sure it was Abby. Wes came in with a stingray, Philip with horseshoe crab, John with horseshoe crab. So let's see. Okay, so the text and the phone call came in at the same time. All right, so why don't we give Abby and Crystal, so I'm going to write that down right now, you will both get an extra credit point today. So Abby and Crystal. Okay. Now with that, there are lots of people obviously that are not able to watch the show live, so I would like to put out another extra credit question that has to do with the horseshoe crab. And we're going to be talking how, well, we've already talked about how arthropods are like bugs, and we'll be talking about ones that live in the ocean as well. But the question, the extra credit question for today for those that are watching the show maybe later or even today if you're watching it live, it's another opportunity. Why are horseshoe crabs more like spiders than crabs, even though we call it a horseshoe crab? So that is the extra credit. Just like all other assignments, make sure you cite your source. And you don't have to actually quote this one, but just let me know where you got your information from. Provide the link so I can double check to make sure you're getting good sites, because you're going to need those good sites for your research proposal. So that's why we're doing this. All right, so extra credit. Why are horseshoe crabs more like spiders than crabs? So good luck. That's an extra credit point that will be open. You can answer in the extra credit section starting tonight. Just as we have in the previous weeks, make sure you attach your answer. Do not post it in the comments, and that will close before next week's class. So, all right, moving on. So, yeah, we wrapped up the last characteristic for these guys as being the compound eyes. And now let's talk about these kind of groupings of animals. So just like we talked about, echinoderms are broken down to sea cucumbers and sea urchins and sea stars. There's a breakdown for arthropods too, right?
Yep, there's four major groups of arthropods, trilobites, chelicerates, insects, and crustaceans. The trilobites, as we know, are extinct. There was an estimated 4,000 different species of trilobites, and they dominated the seas during the Cambrian period, which is about 440 to 400 million years ago. They were a significant group, and they were exclusively marine and mostly benthic, just a few centimeters long, and they were scavengers, or some of them could have been predators. But we see lots of fossils of these in the fossil record. Unfortunately, they're extinct. They're so cute. I'd love to see one.
I always joke that whenever I say something so cute, I'm like, I'm such a girl. I'm like, it's so cute. It's so cute. But I can't help but it is.
Right. So. And then we have the chelicerates, which are spiders and horseshoe crabs. And there are an estimated 70,000 species of chelicerates. We have insects, of course, that's the most numerous group. There are an estimated 948,000 species of insects. And then we have my favorite, which are the crustaceans. And these include the crabs, the lobsters, shrimps, and there are about 67,000 species.
And these are essentially ones that live in the ocean, right? So we're not gonna, are we going to find crustaceans on land?
Well, we may find some in the freshwater or semi-terrestrial, but nothing on land. No.
Right. All right, so it's going to be more of a water-based arthropod, basically. Would that be right?
I take that back, though, because I'm trying to think of those terrestrial hermit crabs.
I
don't know if they need water or not.
That's true. So you can't say all.
But, can't say all.
But a lot, a lot are kind of water-living.
Yeah, they're definitely
arthropods.
Mostly marine, for
Perfect.
Sure. So some other things about crustaceans as they have a wide diversity of form, as we'll talk about, and they range in size from being very large to a 12-foot leg span of our spider crabs that we talked about before, or they can be very tiny. I think there's a crustacean that lives on the antenna of a copepod.
Oh, my gosh.
100 micrometers.
So small.
Very small.
So yeah, there's the picture of our spider crab. So again, they can just be huge. 12 feet, that is so much bigger than ours. Did we say how big ours were?
No, we didn't. But I'm guessing that ours are, if we stretch them out, I'd say they're about 4 to 5 feet from tip to tip of their legs.
So double that, basically, for the biggest ones that have been found.
Yeah,
sure. So super, super big. And moving on with the size and stuff, they play a very important role, right, in the food web.
So yes, they do. All arthropods really do, in the fact that they are critical. Of course, we love to eat shrimp and crabs and lobsters. They are also pests, the insects. Remember, they can be big pests, so they're important for our agricultural needs. And, you know, they have great biodiversity, and they're just wonderful to look at.
It's so funny, like the Japanese beetles or the Japanese June bugs, they called the picture that we use when we first said bugs in the beginning. I love those.
Yeah.
I think they're so beautiful. But I don't know. Some people are afraid of them, but I'm not.
Yeah.
All right, so we are going to be spending a lot more time in crustaceans, because that's what pertains to marine life more so probably than anything else. Well, hard to say, because there's insects on the water too, but anyway, we're spending most of the time on crustaceans. So that's what we will be talking about today. And their body is broken down kind of like you were saying before, right, where they have the head, thorax, abdomen, and then they have a pair of appendages on each body segment. So
yeah, it's kind of interesting. They have 5 segments on the head, 2 pairs of antenna, and compound eyes, as well as these appendages, paired appendages on each segment. So we can maybe take a look at that in just a minute.
We should have a crab anatomy or crustacean segmentation. Either of those pictures should do.
Well, oh, there we go.
There.
Yeah.
Perfect. All right, so if we can pull this up.
Yeah, so you can see the paired appendages are the walking or swimming legs
so
that
like
you see there.
So it's like this one here and then like this one here, right?
Yeah, yeah, and even the claws are paired appendages. And then even the antenna, there are two sets of antenna, but they're paired as well. So everything is really paired. And then inside, we'll go into that a little bit more, but there's gill rakers and hearts and all sorts of fun stuff in there.
Definitely. All right. So that gives us a good idea. And then if we can see, I think we had the crustacean segmentation. There we go. That's what I wanted to see. If we can put that full screen as well. This is a really good, when we're talking about segmentation, what we were talking about.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. This is really great. And it's very interesting to note that through evolutionary history, the basic crustacean form has gone from this elongated sort of shrimp or a lobster-like form to a more advanced form, which is the crab-shaped form, where you see those appendages or those segments on the very end, like the tail.
Down here?
Yeah, essentially, well, even up to like the thorax, that whole tail section, like the part you would eat. Yeah. That throughout evolutionary history has basically evolved into tucking under the thorax so that you go from this long shrimp-like form to a crab.
So you were saying taking this whole section and tucking it up under the thorax.
Right.
And that would essentially be a crab.
Exactly. So it's the same body form, it's just slightly different.
So yeah, because a crab does look much different than this, for example, but doesn't necessarily mean, it's not different because their body structure still has the same kind of idea.
Right.
Interesting, I've never thought about it like that.
Yeah.
I love it. All right, so we're going to jump down and talk a little bit about major groups of crustaceans. These are interesting because you might have heard of some of these and you might not. But copepods, we've talked about copepods a little bit, mentioning in food webs and that kind of thing. But copepods are one of the most abundant, if not the most abundant animal in the world, right?
I think so. They definitely make up a lot of the plankton that we find in the sea. There are about 12,000 species of copepods, and most of these are very small. They range in size from 0.5 to 10 millimeters, so tiny. They can be planktonic or they can be parasitic, which means that they can attach to other organisms and be a nuisance. And they're extremely important as primary consumers in the food web. So first we have the primary producers, and next we have the primary consumers. So these are the guys that eat most of the primary producers.
And we might recognize this from SpongeBob, right?
Oh, yes.
They call it plankton, but they represent copepods. So plankton represents copepods. So they're feeding primarily, depending on the species, right, primarily on phytoplankton.
Correct.
And then with the copepods, we were talking about, what was it that we were saying that lives on the antennae? Something that would be so small.
Oh, yeah, that small. Can you imagine?
I mean, can you imagine something even smaller, a crustacean? It was a crustacean, right?
Yeah.
You're saying? Mm-hmm. That lives on the antennae of a copepod, which is already, you need a microscope to see most of them.
Right.
And then to have something living on that, that's why they're considered the smallest. So,
yep.
Makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
All right, and then next we have amphipods. So, copepods, amphipods. These are a little bit different, though.
Yeah, amphipods are a little bit bigger. They range in size from 1 millimeter to the giant deep-sea benthic species that are about 25 centimeters. But the interesting thing about amphipods is that they are flattened from side to side or laterally. So oftentimes when we go to the beach, from side to side. So oftentimes when you go to the beach, you'll see these as beach hoppers. These are the little things that jump around sort of in the kelp and stuff that's laying on the sand. And some of them are parasitic, including those that like to eat jellies or salps, and then there are many different feeding strategies for the 8,000 species of amphipods that you find, ranging from scavengers to suspension feeders to everything else. So these are called amphipods.
Yeah, that was perfect. When you were saying beach hoppers, the first thing I thought of was a pile of kelp or seaweed washes up on shore. And if you look closely, you just kind of see them hopping around. I actually did a lab on that. We were comparing amphipods to isopods to all these other things in washed up kelp. So
yeah,
that's exactly what I was thinking.
Yeah, yeah, these
and
are
then,
the big toppers.
So we said that they were squished like from side to side, kind of like they were smushed this way, but then opposite of that would be isopods, which are like smushed this way, right?
Right, so they're squished dorsoventrally. And there are about 10,000 species of isopods, and they are marine, freshwater, and terrestrial. In fact, if you come to the Aquarium of the Pacific and look in our new Wonders of the Deep gallery, you'll see these guys, which are giant deep sea isopods. They look just like the roly-polies that you find in your garden. Those are also isopods, but they're terrestrial isopods. These guys are the giant deep sea isopods, or pill bugs. And they are scavengers, and there's about 10,000 species, and they range in size from about 0.5 millimeters to about 500 millimeters, which is about 19 inches.
Wow. And we had seen them, actually. I think we did see them in our deep sea day. We were in Wonders of the Deep, and I think we got a good look at them, but they exhibit giganticism, right? It's kind of like this phenomenon where in the deep, deep water, the deep sea that we were talking about, when they don't get tons of food, they get to be so huge on such little food. And do we have any idea why? Do you know why or how? Or?
Well, I suspect that these guys scavenge a lot on things like whale falls, which are dead whales, whale carcasses that sink to the ocean floor. And they probably eat a lot at one meal. But I was reading that there's an aquarium in Japan who's had one of these for 4 years and it didn't eat. And then finally it ate and it made the news.
Wow. 4 years.
Yeah.
And they can get to be that big.
Yeah.
That's insane.
Yeah,
so,
it's really something.
Yeah, isopods. And I always refer to them like the roly-polies of the sea.
Yeah.
So it's a good way to describe it. All right, so now we're going to move on to the decapods. What's decapod mean?
Deca means 10, so and pod means foot, so it means 10 feet. So basically, these are crabs, and because they have five pairs of appendages, they're called decapods, 10 feet.
So we'll start, and hermit crabs we wouldn't call a true crab, though, right? So you can get a hermit crab as a pet, like we talked about before.
Yeah.
But they are not necessarily a true crab. So let's kind of talk about what makes them so special.
Yeah, they're kind of special because when you count the legs on a hermit crab, you'll see four pairs of appendages, and you'll be like, well, this is a decapod. It's supposed to have a fifth pair, but it actually does. It's just that the fifth pair is very reduced and tucked back sort of towards the back. So here, if you were to count the number of legs we see in this photo, for example, you'll see four pairs of appendages, and then the fifth pair is hidden under the shell, and it actually helps to hold the shell onto the crab's back. So these are very unusual. They have a soft abdomen, and it's usually asymmetrical, so it sort of twists around so it can fit in these gastropod or snail shells.
And I think we were working on getting a picture of a hermit crab without a shell. There we
go. Oh, yeah.
So this is, if we can go pull this full screen real quick.
Yeah, so you can see the small appendages in the very back. That's the fifth pair.
Right back here, right?
Yeah, but they are very reduced, and they help to hold on the shell. So these are very unusual. They're mostly marine, and they usually have a pair of modified pinchers that's used for grasping food and feeding.
I'm thinking of a video for that.
Oh, cool.
Where you can see them like kind of quickly back out and back into a shell.
So they're very quick.
Yeah, they back into the shell. And I love this question because on days where we're dissecting squid, which we will do on our mollusk day, but we'll bring up some of those gastropods, which you'll know that is hopefully at the end of our mollusk day. And I always say, did the hermit crab, or does the snail move into the shell, or does it make the shell? And almost everybody raises their hand because it's been so embedded that the hermit crab moves into the shell, it moves into the shell, it doesn't make the shell, that we all forget to ask, who made the shell?
Right.
So we'll talk about that on mollusk day.
Cool.
All right, Caleb. I think I found an isopod at my tide pool field trip. It was a roly-poly shape embedded in the sand. But why would that be in a tide pool? So why would an isopod be in a tide pool?
I I'm not sure. I'm thinking that this might be one of those sand crabs. If it was embedded in the sand, there are things that look like isopods that are sort of flattened and very small. The next time you go there, look for the segments, because you'll be able to tell. An isopod is very segmented, whereas these sand crabs, they're mostly smooth. You won't see a lot of segments. But I haven't seen really a lot of isopods in the tide pools, but you never know. I would just look for those clues next time you're there to see if you can find
it. Yeah, right? You can investigate. And have they found any missing links between lobsters and crabs? So I'm assuming that you mean like the transition of that, the animal maybe that's tail's only curled under a little bit and not fully, or?
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I can't really think of any off the top of my head. Certainly shrimp and lobsters would be that, but if I think of any, I'll let you know.
Sounds good. Perfect. All right, and then so that kind of breaks down those hermit crabs, and let's talk now about true crabs, which we are going to be dissecting a true crab shortly,
right?
Yeah,
should we bring it out?
Yeah, we can. Let's bring it out and show, so let's show the true crab real quick, and we'll get into a little bit more detail with this a little bit towards the end of class here, but we got a big old true crab
here. So yeah, this is a true crab, and crabs, true crabs are mostly marine. There are some freshwater and some terrestrial and semi-terrestrial. But even the terrestrial crabs are dependent on the ocean for breeding and larval development. There are about 10,000 species of true crabs, and as again, you can see that there are five pairs of legs. The front pair is, again, usually modified as claws or pinchers for grasping food or feeding. So this is a Dungeness crab, one that we like to eat. It has been steamed, so that's why it's orange in color.
What color would it normally be?
Normally it would be like sort of a grayish blue.
Okay, got it. Yeah, no, I know exactly which crab you are talking about. So, all right, we will come back to this guy in just a little bit and explore him or her. What did we say it was? A him?
It's a him.
It's a him. So we'll explore a him and tell you about why we know it's a him in just a little bit. But first, let's go ahead and jump to another decapod, shrimp, which is another animal that we would eat.
Yes, shrimp. There are about 2,600 species of shrimp. Here's a picture of one. Of course, we love to eat shrimp, so they're very important commercially. They often occur in pairs. You'll see pairs of shrimp even at the aquarium. Sometimes they live symbiotically together in anemones or other different places. And some of them are cleaners, where they pick the parasites off of fish. They have a very elongated body. Oh, here's a picture of one cleaning a clownfish. Mm-hmm. This is a scarlet cleaner shrimp. And generally they have an elongated body and a thin shell compared to a crab or a lobster.
Yeah, their shells are much thinner, right? Because if you imagine eating a shrimp, it's easy to get them deshelled versus a crab, where you go to crab houses and you're cracking things open and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Caleb wanted to come back and said the isopod, or whatever it was he found, had about 8 segments and it was shaped like a curled up isopod almost exactly. It was dark blue in color and was kind of rounded like an isopod.
Huh.
It sounds almost like an amphipod to me if it was round, colored or curled up, right?
Yeah, it does kind of sound like an amphipod, especially, and the dark blue sounds familiar too. I think I've seen a lot of them, but you never know, it could have been. Look for that dorso-ventral flattening and you'll be able to tell. If it was like that, then it's an isopod. If it's squished this way, then it's an amphipod.
Yeah, because I mean the amphipods that we see are pretty dark or blue or almost black looking. So I'm wondering if maybe that's what you saw. But get a picture and send it our way and we'll see if we can maybe identify it. That's always the fun part, right? Okay, so another one that we eat, lobsters. Mm. I have only had lobster once in my life, and I didn't like it.
Really?
I don't like to eat seafood. I don't eat shrimp either.
Wow.
I know, I guess I'm missing out.
Yeah, well, it's good. It's good that you don't for the sea. There's more for us. No, lobsters are very cool. Of course, we have our California spiny lobsters, which are found here off of our coast. But the big ones are the Maine lobsters, and they're found off of the East Coast. And the record is over 44 pounds.
Wow.
That's a big lobster. I think some of the biggest lobsters that we have at our aquarium are 18 pounds or so, and they're huge. So I can't imagine a 44-pound lobster.
I think I've seen a picture maybe in the last couple of months, of one that really shocked me in size. I mean, we think of the ones that we eat that fit on a plate, and that's nothing compared to how big they can actually get. So as far as the claws, though, it's another thing. You picture them with claws.
Yeah.
But like, if we were to take a look at this picture, if we can pull this full screen. Getting there. Once it goes full screen, we'll notice that, there we go, that there's no claws on this guy.
No, there aren't any claws. They lack the big claws that we see on the Maine lobsters, and this is because they're mostly scavengers, and they have this big spiny carapace that's used for defense.
So right here, all those spikes.
Whereas the Maine lobster doesn't have a lot of spikes, and they have those big claws to defend themselves. So these guys are mostly nocturnal, our local spiny lobsters, and they hide in the cracks, crevices during the day and come out at night.
Do you know if there's any big differences between the Maine lobster and the California spiny other than the claws and spines? I mean, do they feed differently? Well, they're going to feed differently, but like, do they get different times, or do they hide differently? Or,
you know, I don't really know that much about the Maine lobsters. I do know that it seems like these spiny lobsters, which are found in our temperate waters, are more closely related to the Caribbean tropical lobsters that I've seen, where they also don't have claws. So it must be a way that they feed or something that makes it different.
Yeah, and then if you were to pick one of these up, they can really whip their bodies around, right?
Oh, yeah, they're very powerful. Very hard to collect.
Yeah, I was going to say, didn't they just open up lobster season, too?
Yep, it starts with the month of R, which I guess would be September.
Wow.
Yeah.
So now you can actually go out into our waters and find some lobster. So.
And what's really weird is that we're going to talk about molting in a minute, but all of our lobsters at the aquarium, even though that they're in an exhibit without external light cues or external temperature cues, they all molt at the same time each year, and that's around September.
Wow.
Isn't that weird?
That's really interesting. I wonder what the cue is. Maybe they just can tell time.
I guess. I don't know. But that's the same time that we see lobsters in the wild molting, too.
Yeah.
It's in September.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
The last one we're going to talk about before we go in and really talk in depth about molting is barnacles. So barnacles are another, and I think this is really interesting because on Mollusk Day, when we talk about mussels and clams, especially mussels that attach to hard substrates, people get confused as to whether or not a barnacle is an arthropod or a crustacean or a mollusk like a snail. Mm-hmm. But they are, in fact, a crustacean because they have that jointed appendages, basically.
That's
right?
Right. And if you look at the diagram behind us here, you can see that the feeding legs, they are jointed and they are paired just as they would be in any other crustacean. There are about 1,285 species of barnacles, and these are all suspension feeders, which means these little feeding legs kick out of their protective coating and they catch the plankton and then they draw it back in. So you can think of them sort of as upside down crustaceans, where they're tucked upside down and their legs kick out and grab food and bring it back in. And of course they have this hard shell which they attach to the substrate, and they are crustaceans.
So it's interesting, right? So they're floating as like a little larvae. They attach their head. So they like put their head first, cement their head down, mm-hmm. and then have this like exoskeleton, like their shell almost.
Yeah.
And then it's their feet that just kind of come out and feed. And that's another video I want to do. I want to do so many videos. So video of a barnacle feeding. All right. Perfect. So in here, you can see, like right here, so we can see, oops, sorry, we can go full screen real quick. There we go. So here we've got this large one. So here, and this part right here is the skeleton, or the shell, essentially. And then right in here, that is the body that's tucked away, like essentially in the exoskeleton. And then when, like this one's here, is open. When it's time for feeding, they just open up and come out and use those little feet for filtering. So jointed appendages. If it's jointed, like, it's a crustacean. So
yep.
That's the way I think of it. Well, yeah. That's the way to think of it.
Right, so. Right.
All right, so let's now talk about that molting, because this is kind of a cool phenomenon where, like you said, they shed their exoskeleton.
Right. Right. So this is a process called ecdysis, and all arthropods go through this process because this is the only way they can grow because they're, again, constrained by this hard exoskeleton. So when we usually see a crab or a shrimp, it's usually in a period called the intermolt, and that's sort of in between molts. Mm-hmm. And during this time is where real tissue growth occurs. Then when it's time to molt and to shed this new skin, they release a hormone called ecdysone, and this ecdysone actually creates enzymes that allows a separation between the old exoskeleton and the new one that's underneath. And the new exoskeleton is very soft. It's not quite as hard as this outer one is. So what they do is they will start with a pre-molt, and these enzymes start separating the exoskeleton. The new cuticle underneath is formed, and then this old exoskeleton begins to split away. And the animal, all the linings actually are lost during the molting process, but they begin to wiggle out of this old shell, mm-hmm. and then they'll back out, and it's a very energetically expensive process. So it takes them sometimes quite a long time. With our giant spider crabs, it takes sometimes a day, which is too long. We try to help it along because as it's coming out, it's like expanding and swelling. And the size difference of some of these is just incredible when you see it.
It's almost like they got too tight in their skin.
So right.
But it's actually their exoskeleton. We have right. a video of an aquarium spider crab molting. So we want to show you that real quick, and then we're going to dive right into the dissection. So if okay. we can pull that video up, we'll watch about a minute of it, and then we will start our dissection. So Sandy, while you're grabbing the crab, maybe I don't know if we can talk about both. What's going on here?
Well, here is an overhead shot of one of our giant spider crabs, and you can see sort of the pinkish part to the left is the big body of the new spider crab. So this is the new, and the part that you see on the right is the old carapace. So this is the crab pulling out, and you can see its legs and everything are coming out of this old skeleton, and it's very soft and vulnerable at this point. So at the aquarium, what we do is actually isolate it behind a barrier to separate it from the other crabs, because the other crabs and the other fish in the exhibit will take advantage of this nice new soft meal. But it's just amazing when you see each leg and each gill and everything, the eyes, the antenna, everything is new, and even all of those delicate little mouth parts are new. So it's a really amazing process to watch.
He's almost out, just backing up those last legs there, last parts of the legs. And then it's just almost like he's gonna spring free, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and I'm sure it feels so good to get out of there.
Yeah. Almost there. All right, he did it.
Wow, look at that.
So that is how it's done.
Yay.
Perfect.
And here in the background, we're all cheering.
Yay! All right, well, let's jump into our dissection. We have about 5 minutes to go over all of this stuff. So let's take a look. Sandy, what do you got? Because I've never done this before.
Okay, so this is one of our Dungeness crabs, and you can get these at the local seafood market. For many of you crab lovers, you may know how to do this already, but just to show you that this is the carapace, of course. The eyes are here. The antenna are in the front. You can see the pinchers and even some of the barnacles that we had just talked about are on the shell itself and the legs. I'm going to flip it over now, and you can tell that this, the one way you can tell different sexes is the male and the female. The male, we will have what we call the Washington Monument.
Yeah.
It's where this long abdomen sticks straight up, but whereas on a female, it's a very round apron like the Capitol building. So if you're into Washington, you know what I'm talking about. Here also are the mouth parts, and again, these are paired appendages. So for everyone on one side, there's another one on the other side. And then remember again, we said paired appendages, so even the reproductive organs, this is a male, so these are the pleopods, which are used to insert the sperm into the females. And I'm just going to take off the carapace, so I'm just going to stick my thumb in the back under the carapace and lift it up. And I might have destroyed some organs there, so it won't be as pretty a dissection as possible. But you can see now that I've taken the carapace off, and now we have some different, you can really clearly see the mouth parts here. And then the gills are located along the back here. These are all gills. And then inside we have some internal organs, some hepatopancreas and stomach. Some people like to eat that part. I'm not very fond of it myself, but it's very interesting how the crab will actually respire. Now that you can see the location of the gills along the side here, the crab actually brings water through specialized holes along the carapace and brings them in, flushes water over the inside, and then pushes them out through the mouth parts. So the crab actually is always respiring and needs to be in water to respire. Now, if we really wanted to take a look at some of the muscles of the crabs, you can see this is the part that we like to eat a lot. Are these back, we'll take a back section off, and you can see all of this, which is usually white meat back here. These are the really strong muscles that allow the crabs to move these legs in any fashion. And again, these legs are all paired, and these are used in the Dungeness crabs for walking, but some of them are specialized, like these back legs, for swimming. So instead of having a pointy walking leg, they will actually have a flattened paddle on the end and be able to swim, like the Chesapeake Bay crabs.
So I think that's really cool to show. I mean, just that back one in comparison, like you said, is very thin. Can we kind of show that again?
Sure.
It's like they're like swimlets or something, right? Like,
yeah, yeah. These are for walking, of course, on soft substrate, but some of them are flattened and really big and paddle-like. And then, of course, the pinchers are very interesting, too, where the claws are used in this case for scraping stuff or cutting. You can see the teeth on the claw there, as opposed to being crushers, which are also pretty used for like crushing different things. So,
how strong is a crab's claw? I mean, if we were to put our finger in there, what could happen?
Oh, it would hurt. Oh, it would hurt. Yeah, it could definitely cut you for sure, depending on what kind of crab it is. But crabs are so strong and powerful, you don't want to get near those claws.
And if they do grab on, is there a way to get them off? Or, I mean, what do you do?
No, I would just shake as hard as you can and scream a lot. Go, please, somebody help me.
Yeah, that's really funny. I've always wondered. I remember seeing a video of like someone one was on its back and they were feeling around and this crab, and it wasn't a Dungeness crab, but it grabbed on, and I was just thinking, oh my gosh, how would you get it off? Like,
yeah.
What would you do? Because they're strong.
Yeah, and it's just instinct. Like, they don't let go. They really don't. They'll hold on until maybe you hit them with something, or yeah. I don't want to suggest torturing the crabs out there, but only in case of an emergency.
Right. Well, you wouldn't ever want to be around the claws, like you said, anyway.
I mean,
but just on the rare chance, so who knows. But,
right.
All right. Well, that just about wraps up our session for today. So we got to look a little bit in depth at a crab. And, of course, if you wanted to get one yourself, you could do the same thing and just explore and see if you can figure out what some of that stuff is. So, no crabs were hurt in the teaching of this class. So, yes, this crab was already a goner and was ready to be sold and eaten off the market. So,
yes.
Definitely true. All right. So, don't forget, you have discussion board, quiz, and then next week we'll be doing the midterm. If you have any questions, continue to email me. I love it when I hear from the students. I'd love to know that you're engaged. And otherwise, we will see you next week. Have a good week, guys.